Hello again, and this is where I go to Tikal Ancient City in Guatemala, and I got up pretty early, not ridiculously early, to get on a ride, and there's a gorgeous little road and ride to the ancient city, which is actually it's in a whole big national park, and because most, you know, like you'll find a lot of these are like tourist attractions. When they're really popular with internationals, like myself, travellers, they're usually pretty expensive. And this was about $35, and I think I paid a few dollars extra for the car, for my motorbike as well. $35 entry fee. It starts at, you can enter at 6 a.m. and you must leave by 6 p.m. They also have a sunrise tour that is an organised tour that you can go before as the sun comes up. And that's a little bit more. They normally have something for citizens, like they have a day that's, nearly all of these have, like especially the national monuments and things like that, they'll have a day like that's for, like Machu Picchu has a day that, I think it's Sundays, that is for anyone from the country, from that, for any resident gets in free or for a very, very little amount for those days. But you'll find that as a tourist in any of the big tourist locations, which in a lot of them I try to avoid because they're not that great anyway, but this one was, you know, quite special. Absolute gorgeous ride. Road was okay, nothing amazing, but usually the roads to the national parks and all that are usually a little bit better than this one, but still good fun riding. Took the jacket off for today because it was so hot and not the smartest move by any long shot. I don't recommend ever taking your riding gear off, but I knew that despite my research I had to walk about a kilometre and a half uphill to get to the monument and from the parking spot, and I knew that having my jacket with me, which I could have put in the back case, in one of my cases, which I had it in my case, but it was just so hot and I just didn't want to get there and just be all sweated up, because whenever you get to these national parks you've got to stop at the booths and you've got to get off, and basically with the jacket I was just going to be sweating. I sweat, I mean superhuman sweating I do, I remember when I used to play football, Australian rules football, and I could lose like 3 to 5 kilograms in a game of football, you know, just in fluids, you know, even though, and I'm still drinking, you know, while I'm playing, it's not like I'm drinking. Pretty sweaty guy. So this took out Tikal Ancient City. It's probably out of all the Mayan ruins I've visited, easily the best that I visited. Now, there are some that I didn't visit that are supposed to be very good as well, but this is in a rainforest. It's lush, you know, and you notice the temperature change once you get into a really dense rainforest. The temperature actually drops a little bit, you know, and they seem to have a lot of deciduous type trees as well. Reminded me a little bit of some of the Australian forests, but then once you started going up the mountain, you had all the, you know, all the local sort of plants that doesn't look like anything like Australia. Australia's got rainforests, but only a few of them. So it's just amazing how beautiful it is. You honestly think that when you get there, it's so well preserved. You honestly think you're on a movie set because it is quite spectacular, and you'll see by some of the photos that are coming up now, there wasn't that many people there. This is fairly early in the morning, maybe about 8 a.m. There's a few buses getting there. As I was leaving, there was a lot more buses on the road back that were coming in. I think the majority of them probably get there around 10 a.m. You can spend a fair while there. I spent about 2 hours there, walking around, just having a drink and relaxing, and just went, you know, there's all these different monuments all throughout the park, and they're a fair way apart of each other. So there's a fair bit of walking to do. But yeah, well worth it climbing up to the top of a couple of them and just getting a shot, because they're, I mean, absolutely spectacular. And when you learn of the history, like I think it was, it began in 400 BC. And a lot of the Mayan sites, they don't know a lot about the Mayan sites. But this one here had basically all the rulers. There's a lot of the tombs there. And there was some, obviously, writing and stuff like that. So they've actually got a really good history of Tikal. And they've even got a hierarchy of when people died and even the dates that they died, which is quite impressive. But it is it's a fantastic place. You really feel like you can just sit there, and I love doing that, just sitting there imagining it being alive and all this sort of stuff happening, you know, the townspeople, the rulers and all that sort of stuff. I mean, what fascinates me about, it's never about what people think, it's why they think that way, you know. And you can usually, whether it's somebody who's really political or somebody who's really religious, you can usually pin it to, you know, obviously their upbringing. And you know, some people just have, are just easily led, you know, so you can basically tell them anything. In these sort of times, they worshipped, you know, 400 BC, 500 BC, 1000 BC, most of them were worshipping, here I'm giving my ticket. I'm pretty sure I already paid. I had a station, I had to pay it. I'd already paid by this stage. So you pay as you get entrance to the park, and then you've got about 5 to 10 miles of riding to get into the main area. But I'm more interested in not what people think, because what people think is usually, it says a lot about them, but why they think that way. So if you look back, you know, there was pretty much nothing understood about the natural phenomena of the planet. So people worshipped, you know, they had gods and devils and things like that. And usually the gods were, you know, the sun, the moon, and the punishment was floods and lightning and thunder and volcanoes and things like that. But, you know, now that we all understand, you know, the natural world is so much better, you know, most of those have pretty much gone by the wayside. I mean, if you had a god, you'd probably have to call it, you know, a rather benign god, but you'd have to call it the sun, you know, because the sun gives life to pretty much everything on our planet. You know, the moon, you could have the moon as well if you want, but actually having something that controls anything is, as far as mind or thoughts or, you know, anything like that is a little bit silly. But this is all they understood, so they didn't know. And so what you had is you had those sort of things, and then you had conduits to those gods, which are usually the emperors and things like that. I mean, we have it today in, say, North Korea. You've got that little fatty. He thinks he's a god, and he thinks his father is a god, and the father before him, and the people do too. If you read all about what they promote to their people, is they promote, they promote these amazing feats, unnatural feats from each of them, you know, 18 holes in one, and all this sort of crap, you know, but can never be tested. So no one could ever say, okay, let's go out on the golf course and see if he can do something. You know, probably shoot 130, you know, little fatty. You know, so most gods now are pretty much easily dismissed, because we understand so much about things. And you can test, you know, and so I'm always interested in that sort of stuff. I'm sort of like, it annoys some people, but I said in a previous video, I hate anecdotal evidence, you know. Look at this, look how beautiful this is. It's just spectacular. I mean, they've even done all the thatched roofs and on some of the structures and things like that, but it's simply gorgeous, you know, absolutely stunning. And you can actually climb up a lot of these and get to the top of them which I did, and I got a few photos. It was pretty, it wasn't that high, but it was, you know, that walking up there was pretty tough work, you know, especially in the heat of the place. But just the lawns and just the gardens, everything was just so well maintained, and really amazing credit to them. And that's where I parked my motorbike. Most of the other bikes were just people. Mine's a huge bike compared to everyone else. So I'm always fascinated by the way people think and why they think that way. And I mean, you know, I don't go around questioning people what their beliefs are unless they want to challenge me, because I don't believe in anything. I don't believe in anything supernatural. I just think that, you know, I like to unshackle myself from having to bow down to anybody. I just don't think that it serves any purpose. You know, it might be true, but there's just zero evidence that any of it is. Even though there are benefits to organised faiths and things like that, community and stuff like that, but once you drill down into what they actually believe and why people believe that, you know, most people don't believe in their own religion. If I said to them, okay, what about these rules? Oh no, don't. You know? But so it's sort of like a la carte, you know. But anyway, it's not such a big deal. I don't really have any issues. You know, I've got a lot of I've got some friends who don't believe in anything. I've got friends who are really, really, really strong believers in stuff like that. As long as they stay out of my way and don't try to tell me how to live my life, I'm pretty much fine with it. So I went on a bit of a rampage then, sorry. But I'm really interested in that side of things, on, you know, what, not only who the emperors or who the kings and queens were, but what they actually stood for, you know. I found that, you know, throughout Europe and Eastern Europe, with a lot of the queens, is a lot of the queens actually did things for the country. Like a lot of parks in Bulgaria and places like that, and even in Russia, you know, they were set up by the queen. The king built a massive statues for himself, you know, or the rulers, male rulers seem fascinated with their own selves and making sure there's monuments and statues to themselves everywhere, so that when they go, they're still friggin' revered for whatever reason. But I found that women in a lot of these countries actually did some things, even though they would have been just, you know, pretty ordinary people, I imagine, and would have had a lot of things given to them for being born into a certain family. But they did try to do some things, and some of the beautiful parks that I visited and all that were basically all set up by queens and things like that. So it sort of always interests me about, you know, what they did, what people believed about them, you know, what they sort of try to get over everybody. And usually they did try to get something over people, that they were a conduit to either a god or to the gods or to some sort of entity above them, and so people were to fear them. But most of the time they just had the military strength behind them, and people were scared of them. I'm sure people revered them because they heard all these stories that weren't true but could never be tested. But yeah, so from there I went to Flores, which is it's a little seaside, lakeside city, quite beautiful, very much influenced by the Spanish. The thing about all these conquests all through time, for the majority of them, the conquerors, you know, with all the bad shit that obviously happened, you know, architecture, this is having a little bit of a stop. I always look for some places like this, you know, a really cool little spot on the road, have a bit of a break. There's some horses wandering around. Had my break, had a drink, got to eat, off I went. So usually I go get something to eat and then I'll pack it in my tank bag. Always carry plastic bags in my tank bag, so I'm going to put food in them, I can put them in the plastic bag. I headed to Flores. So I actually had to go past where I was staying at the hotel, because I was just staying outside of Flores. Yeah, so I had to go past it, then back again, but I mean, I had plenty of time. This is still only about 1 p.m. in the day, so... I decided to go to Flores and Peten, kept thinking of myself, and have some lunch there the late afternoon. It was about 3 p.m., 2 p.m. by the time I sat down and had lunch, and then had a bit of a ride around. I took some 360 videos of the joint. So whenever you get near towns, you'll get the little motorbike carts, as well as the you know, a lot of mopeds. A lot of, more and more as I went down in Central America, just a lot of people on mopeds. And there's a lot of cheap bikes, a lot of cheap Indian bikes and Chinese bikes in these cities. You know, that most of them can't go more than say 45 mile an hour. And they're all, as you can see, that most of them sit on the right side of the road because they're going pretty slow. But yeah, I really liked it. I really liked Flores. It was a beautiful city. A lot of cobblestones, stuff like that. And when you've got a big motorbike like mine, you know, I mean, I nearly came unstuck in a couple of the cities. I'm trying to think, the city that where I went to Machu Picchu in Peru, the Airbnb I was staying at was just on a massive hill. And not only that, the directions from the Google Maps, they didn't have the correct directions on the Airbnb. When you clicked on it to go on the Google Map, you put the address in, it put you in another location, and it was like up the most ridiculous hill, and it was wet, and the bike was just slipping on the cobblestones, big heavy bike, and then you've got your feet slipping on the cobblestones, not fun. And then they had a trench on each side in the cobblestone, so if cars were coming the other way, you had to go up outside of a trench, which the bike just didn't want to do. So yeah, you have some fun. Cobblestones look really pretty, but unless you're pretty careful on your bike and you've got a fair bit of weight on your bike, you always want to be a bit careful. You saw then I just went past another hole in the road where the road workers basically just, there's one crew that goes, that cuts the road open where there's a pothole, and then another crew comes, there's another one there, then another crew comes back later, or coming through later, and actually puts the bitumen back in, or the tarmac back in the road. I just went over a bit. So see those cuts in the road? So that's one crew just cutting the road open. So some of them are just like an inch deep, but some of them are like 3 or 4 inches, you know. You can see another one there. And that just happens all throughout Guatemala, Honduras, El Salvador. It's a weird thing, you know. You think you'd have the crew would cut it open, would seal, and then they put the stuff over the top of it as well, the bitumen over the top to fix it, but they don't. And a lot of the time they don't put anything there. Sometimes they put a water bottle to warn you, but you're going around a corner, and that's where I came off in Honduras. You come around a corner, you're not thinking that there's going to be a huge ditch not filled in. And this one that I had the little crash on was freaking massive. Like it was like at least 6 inches deep, maybe deeper, and just with a water bottle. And I was on the corner, but basically as you come around the corner and you hit the corner, I've got this one, the video sped up, but you hit the corner as you're just coming out of the corner. And so when you're coming out of a corner, you're basically on the inside, and then you sort of drift a little bit to the middle as you accelerate. And this was right as I was doing that, and then bang, it just came up on me, and then off I went. So luckily, I was just starting to accelerate when I saw it, but off I came, you know. I didn't get hurt or anything, just the bike just went ahead of me, and I just got popped straight up in the air, basically. Landed on my ass, and luckily I had my gear on, and I had my backpack, so I landed on my ass, but I also had my wet weather gear in the backpack, which is padding. So a really good hint for your backpack is the part, if you lay back on your back, you want to have any of your riding gear there. You don't want to have like a spray can or anything hard that can really hurt you in the center of the backpack, you know. So you want to make sure you've got that. I had my extra gloves. I had like a plastic boot covers. So for my boots, even though my boots were waterproof, if it was really bad, I just thought, well, bugger it, just I put that on just for a little bit extra. And I had some I had some, I had a raincoat type thing to put on. My pants were waterproof and my jacket was waterproof, but if it was really, really bad, I had this coat that basically zipped up right up to my chin. And so it just gave me that extra. And I used to wear that underneath my jacket because it was very thin. I think we're coming into the town pretty shortly, the town of Flores. The pricing for stuff in Guatemala, like, you know, getting beers and stuff like that, was it's pretty much the norm all throughout. You know, you're still paying around about $15 for $15 to $20 for a dozen beers. But the smart thing to do is to always get the local beer, you know, because it always will be cheaper. I stopped at this place a few times on the left there to get some supplies and stuff. They sell a lot of water in these countries. So that's really cheap. Just getting bottled water is really cheap. Not that I, you know, filter tap water is fine for me pretty much for anything. So I have a water bottle. I've got a water pack in my backpack, and so I've got like a nozzle that comes out. So I always put it like a little, you know, half a dozen ice cubes in that in the morning with some water, and that lasts me pretty much most of the day. Stays reasonably cool for most of the day. But you know, sometimes you just want to get some sugar in you, a bit of energy. So just a bottle of Coke or Diet Coke or Pepsi or whatever you want. You'll find that the countries, you know, different countries seem to be supporting either Pepsi or Coca-Cola. So yeah, there's a big shopping centre here on the left. I stopped in there on the way back as well. But this is getting into Flores, and all this is sort of pretty much all modern sort of junky sort of crap. Shops and gas stations and things like that. And then as you get further down, you get into the old part of town, which is really pretty. I was really surprised at the amount of military installations in Guatemala. I don't know how much military they've got, but it seems pretty huge. Pretty much a waste of money, but obviously it's a jobs program, just like any of those things. So yeah, you get into here and then you've got to turn off to get onto the little, sort of like a little island type thing, surrounded by water, which is really cool. And you go over a bridge to get to it. I got a little bit lost here, I think. I think I needed to turn right up here or something. I didn't. Oh no, I did. Well done, Peter. Good work. So yeah, you go over this bridge and you're getting onto the island. Pretty cool place. I love going out. I love bridges, you know, especially the old ones. The big old iron ones and stuff like that are really cool. And when you get into further South America, you get like really like wooden, a lot of wooden ones that are really cool, you know. They're usually pretty small. So here I've got no idea where I'm going. And plus, the big thing to look out for in towns is to look out for one-way streets. Most of them they'll have an arrow, so they'll have the name of the street and an arrow. So you know, and if the arrow is going both ways, you know it's a two-way street. Sometimes they don't have anything, and you just end up riding up it. And everyone looks at you, go, where are you going? So now this is where I'm trying to work out how to get around to the waterfront side of things. But as you can see, you know, pretty cool architecture throughout, usually ruined by anything built in the 20th century, in the latter 20th century, where they didn't actually have, you know, a lot of these places didn't have any walls as far as what type of style could be built. I'm trying to work out which way I'm going. I think I made the same mistake again here, and then have to go around all the way around again. Trying to work out whether it's a one-way street. Yeah, it looks like a one-way street. I agree. Still go up there. Yeah, I end up going right again, I think. I was trying to work out how to get to the far side so I could go and do a loop around. Still not certain that I'm on a two-way street here, by the way. I'm pretty sure it's a one-way street and I just made a mistake. Yeah, so I was trying to get around to the right there. And I think this was a one-wayer as well. Yeah, I just worked out that was a one-wayer as well. I was pretty hungry by this time too. I wanted to have a drink. There's some people having a swim in the water. I got out here and took a couple of photos. Bike. boom, boom. See how quick it is? If you've got your, with your camera, if you've got your location turned on, it's good to know, because when you save, like I, with my photos, everything is saved to Google Photos. So as soon as I take it, as soon as I got Wi-Fi access, it backs up all my photos. And it's fantastic to have, and Google then will treat the photos as well. The smart thing to do with Google Photos is to, in your phone settings, to upload originals. You know, you get quite a lot of space. I'm paying for extra space now because I'm well over 1 terabyte of data. But I've got like over 100,000 photos and videos in my on my Google Photos. I've even scanned all my old photos and put them in there. You know, got a really good scanner and then got rid of them because, you know, carrying them around everywhere you go. Not much fun, and so I scanned them all over with a good quality scanner, and then I tossed all the photos of me when I was a kid and playing football as a kid and cricket and all my friends as growing up. Yeah, so now I think I worked out, and I do this again. I think I just start following a couple. Yeah, so I see these people up there, and I follow them. They might know what they're doing to get around to the other side. A pretty rough road, you know. It's one of those Japanese bikes, that's Japanese, Indian bikes, I think. You see them everywhere. Taking their time. Okay. Always give people a smile. So you can see the arrow there pointing that way, one way. Yeah, so as you go around this island, you can see that it's there's some pretty low-lying areas and a lot of flooding, which they're going to have to do a fair bit of work to keep that from happening. You know, there's a lot of cities I've been in the world where flooding, you know, especially as the seas are rising and flooding is becoming, especially with king tides, like I live in Miami Beach, and we're going to have to spend billions of dollars, the city is going to have to spend billions of dollars lifting up Miami Beach with the tides, and then we're going to have a lot of erosion with the sand, because the sand, Miami Beach is a huge beach, it goes for miles and miles and miles, yet it's all, sand is all fake. They've got to bring in the sand, not all of it's fake, but a lot of it is, and they've got to continually chop up, you know, hundreds of thousands of tons a year of sand. So Miami Beach is going to be a pretty big work in progress. As you see as I come around here, you'll see shortly that as it gets low towards the lake there, you'll see that once the lake, they might just end up just draining big parts of the lake, I don't know. But there was quite a bit of water. I don't think I stopped you. No, I didn't. For a place to park. I was looking for a place to park and grab some lunch. Always fun to waddle back on your motorbike as well. I saw that van there was from Argentina. It was a real cool old van done up, and they're obviously doing a big trip around. It's pretty cool. I think I stopped in here and had some lunch, which was really nice. Like I get. I have my side cases on. I have to pay for parking in these sort of towns. That's me leaving again. Get a bit slower there. There's some people swimming in the lake as well. It's pretty cool. I think we've been past this place already. A really nice town. A lot of backpackers in the city. In this part of the town, there's a lot of backpacking places, hostels. They look pretty average to me. But a really pretty little place, you know. Obviously, during high season, it'd be filled with people. There's about three or four hostels on this stretch here. This is the off season, so there's not a lot of people around. I think the high season is, you know, as soon as it gets cold in North America, the tourists come down I stopped here as well and had a bit of a break on the bike and go once around again. This time I go all the way to the end. And I did a 360 video, which you can see under my 360 videos of this. Get a little bit better view. Sign up there, Peten, which I cut off the end to make it Peter. Got some photos. So I have two phones. I've got my Galaxy S7 Edge there, and that's what I use for my calls. And I used just a Galaxy S7, just the basic version, which is still like $800 for all my sat nav. So basically, I had one of my phones. Just basically, all it had on it was all my KTM apps, my communications. So I only had about 5 or 6 apps on it. That was it. So I just used that for my navigation. So this is where you'll see that there's some low-lying areas on this side, on this loop, because I finally worked out how to get around, which was basically right from the start when I came into the town. I could have gone there, but a bit of trial and error. And as you can see, there's lots of places where people can sit by the water, and it is quite beautiful though. A really pretty little place. And I suggest if you're going to go to Tikal, you're probably going to stay in this town anyway. But I would stay in this area, the old part of town. The other part of town, the more modern part of town, is pretty crappy. Just ask this guy if he was okay, and he was fine. Not that I could have helped him much, but I've got some tools on me. I helped a couple of people on the way who just had got flat tyres, just with my compressor. So you can see here, it's pretty low. The water. So I'm sure they can control that. This is a bit rough here. When you see all those cobblestones out of the ground, you're thinking, okay, great. There's nothing more embarrassing than dropping your bike in front of a whole bunch of people, which I've nearly done a couple of times. Once when I braked, when I had to go parking, I braked and I just wasn't thinking. And then I nearly tipped the bike, had to use all my strength to keep the bike up in front of a whole bunch of people at a bar. A little bit embarrassing. You'll see this a lot too, with people in the back of pickups, just a whole bunch of kids and stuff like that. You know, a lot of that's like taxis, you know, and all throughout Central America and South America, you'll see like a pickup truck with like 15 people in the back of it, you know, it's crazy. Which I'm pretty sure is outlawed in most countries now, most modern countries anyway. But yeah, so Flores, a really pretty spot. If you can get find some good accommodation there, great. I never looked there. I stayed in a nice place out of town. Then the next night, I spent camping, and I made the mistake. I think I've got a photo of my camping expedition, which was not a very smart move. So I stayed outside of Tikal and did some camping there. Had growler monkeys or whatever making the. These growler monkeys, they're not big monkeys, but they feel, by their sound, it sounds like they're about 12 feet tall. You know? Pretty slow there. So here's just a few little photos to finish off the video that's where I stopped on the way. On the way back, some horses just wandering around. That place was closed, it was in front of me. There's that photo that I took. There's that van, really cool, hey? I love that sort of thing. I'm not sure what sort of van that is. That's the view from where I was having lunch. But then you saw me take that photo. So whenever you can, you stop, and that's the hotel, that's the swimming pool, the hotel that I stayed at. Very beautiful. Water was nice and cool too. I don't like it when the water's warm. In hotels, you get that in South America where you get these hotels and you think, oh, I'm going to jump in the water. You jump in and the water's like the air temperature. You know, it's like a spa. So nearly all those shops, you can get basic foods. a lot of them, you know, it's a lot of modern stuff in there now, like, you know, everything's in plastic and stuff like that. If you really want to get food, something to eat, you've got to do the street food. It's the only option and it's the best option by a mile. Especially if you're on a budget, you know, you're so much, you can see people there. Usually there's a little bit of a barbecue going. There's like a nice little Spanish church. You see them everywhere. Really nice churches there, me having a break somewhere along the road. I always try to pick a really nice spot to have a break. I didn't have my breaks at gas stations. I got my gas and then moved on and went to look for a nice spot to relax and sit down. Rather than, to, you know, some people say have to stop at gas stations for your breaks. That's ridiculous. It's boring and shit. Get your ass somewhere and just look for, get your food or whatever you want to get. Get your drinks, refreshments, and then get on the road and find it. That's a beautiful place. So find a nice place to relax and you know, spend 10, 20. I used to work on 2 hours. There's me riding at night to my camping spot. I used to spend 2 hours at night. 2 hours and then 45 minutes stop. Anyway, questions or comments below. Thanks, guys.